it's all said and done. LinkedIn giving me a problem.
Says the stream is live. For what that's worth.
Yes, we are here. We are here. Good day, everybody. This is Nathaniel Evans, host of IAMTHEDATA podcast. I'm with my infamous guest, Ronald G. Stewart. This is our second time around, the first time around.
Yes, sir.
Technical difficulties, but you know, today we're here and we're talking about the era of excellence. And I basically, when I look at Ronald, I see the era of excellence, you know, illuminating the golden path of business. You know, what business looks like and how we able to basically contribute into nice little packages and nice little boxes, right? You know, and do some phenomenal things with it and connect with some phenomenal people along the way. You know, this is not, I guess when you look at society, like the journey of the individual, but you know, Ronald has showed you that, you know, this is the journey of collectivity, you know, of collaborations, you know, and actually seeing insight and seeing purpose of other people in the world and actually allowing them to tap into who he is so they can actually reach higher plateaus as he has done all these years. You know, and with that, I want to bring Ronald to the table. We're going to have a discussion as we always do. The floor is yours, brother.
It's the way forward, discussion.
Yes, the floor is yours. Let's have a discussion.
Okay, so I believe in the future, folks. I think the country has phenomenal opportunity. We're going through a lot of trauma right now for a lot of people as they watch the shenanigans in the legislature of the United States and Congress, and you get a little bit concerned. I'm concerned that we're going to shut down the government for a couple of weeks, and it looks more like it every day. But you can't worry about that. You have to turn in order and you can get to the money you need to operate for a few weeks, things like that. But you can't. That's all background noise. You are you, and you know where you're going and what you'd like to accomplish. And what you'd like to accomplish is the first step in your journey, or the second step, or the tenth step, whatever it is. You keep your eye on the ball, and you keep going toward your goal. And if you do that, chances of you ending up in a good place are pretty fantastic when you really look at it. So, I know his mother and I are very close, and he's written a book. And his book is basically why white males like myself had a leg up all in the path of this country. I haven't read the book yet, but I love the ideas he's talking about because that's important. So what we need to do, people like us joint collectively, is to work together to kind of balance that's my goals in life now. Now that I know my kids and the rest of my family are all secure, and I'm doing everything I can to make the love of my life secure, okay? And her kids. I have all that's off my mind. Now, what do I want to do for the future? What I want to do for the future is do everything I can to level out that playing field. Well, even by the time I die, right? I'm 76. It's not going to be. But if we don't work toward that goal, greater profit, and I see evidence of it all the time, I listened to the governor of Maryland today, and he has a wonderful message about how America is headed in the right direction. We're doing the right things. We're trying to make opportunity for everyone. We're trying to rebuild the middle class. There's so much we have to do because it's really been being destroyed over the last year. And so we got to a high point, and then people start tearing it down. And then now I think, I believe, we're on a trajectory that means America really does have a chance. I don't know if I'm allowed to be political here, Nathan.
Yeah, you got it. You know, we're having a discussion. You know, we're having a discussion. You know, and you know, and the discussion is no right and wrong. You know, we meet people along the way, and you know, it's so many different perspectives, ideologies out here. You know that there is no right and wrong. A lot of these stuff that's out here is opinionated, right? And we try to find sense of the world that we live in, and we only could do that in real-time discussions. You know, I'm in school right now doing my master's in public administration. You know, I'm basically on my last leg right now. I only got like 4 more weeks to finish, you know, and it's done. And even in that classroom, the discussions that we're having about politics and, you know, our association to politics and, you know, even, you know, you don't even know why you're in the room. It's a discussion where one of the professors said, you know, do you love government? And people are like, no, I don't love government. I don't love government. They say, well, you know, you have to love government if you're taking a public administration class, a master in public administration class. You have to have love for government because this curriculum within itself is directly connected to the government. And they're like, oh, wow. You know, I didn't know that I was directly connected to the government by taking this course, and you actually are. You know what I mean? So it's basically learning like the true frameworks of what the society is based on and how we are able to pivot and move forward. You know, we're dealing in an age of excellence that you're talking about. And the only way you can move in excellence is by knowledge, you know, wisdom and knowledge. You know what I'm saying? You have to be able to apply both of those spectrums together in order to be able to increase in the society. You know, there is no one size fit all model, you know. And some of the entrepreneurs I'll be following sometime, you said nobody knows nothing. Right? I mean, like, that's like a great concept to show, like, you know, even if you know something, you don't know all things of it, because there are different spectrums within the things that you know, that you also need to know. As Henry Ford said it the best, I don't need to know nothing. All I need to know is the people that know what I need to know, right? And it's basically, you know, starting to reframe your mind, reframe your heart, your spirit, according to what's actually happening in this time. Like we have a lot of texts, we have a lot of religious contexts out there that we use to try to define the world, but those things are in past tense, and we are acting in present tense, looking to go into a physical, basically a future space that's actually going to be defining and definitive moments for our lives. Are you able to hear me? Because you have like some type of delay there, but we're good.
You are right. Well, I'm just. Yeah. Fascinated by what you're seeking. So you have 4 weeks left to get your degree.
Yeah. I got 4 more weeks. It's over. Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah, this is crunch time right now.
Congratulations. You know,
just writing out some papers. Thank you, bro. I appreciate
that's
it.
That's totally impressive.
Yeah, you know, and I helped a couple of my classmates along the way as well. You know,
so
it's a delay. I can't hear you what you said.
Good. I'm just so impressed that you've been through this. And that's just remarkable. I'm totally impressed.
I appreciate it, brother.
What current caseload or password? What's your current
password? I'm doing I'm doing 8 classes at the same time.
Okay.
Yeah,
motivated.
I took the bulk of it. I didn't split anything up, you know, and I just went, you know, head first into the storm, you know, to see what's there for me, what's presented to me when I get to the other side. You know, it's the challenges of life to actually be able to walk in that power, you know, face those challenges head on, you know, and learn the consequences of those challenges that you're taking in real time. You know, you may be looking for the best road travel, but you won't know what the best road travel is until you travel on that road. There is no golden arrow that's pointing you like you're doing a Google map and saying, this is the way you're supposed to go, right? You have to have this insight on who you are and say, okay, I think this is the path that I should go. I think I should turn this corner instead of this corner. And you might get misdirected by your own guidance, but you have to stop in the road and say, Ronald, do you know where such and such place is at? Because I can't get there on my own, right? It's actually learning about who you are as you're going through this golden path of your life, right? Illuminating your golden path. You know, your business is not just, you know, me being an entrepreneur, or me having an LLC, a nonprofit. The business of life is actually you in association to that business that you're actually trying to do to basically, like you said, reframe your life or put your life, you know, in some type of context where you can actually look at it and say, you know, this is the path that I selected and this is the path that's worthy of me actually putting my whole mind, body, and soul in this path so I can actually get the fruits of my labor out of this journey.
Right. You have to know where you're going, or at least have an idea. And that'll change. That'll change all the time. I knew from a very early age that I wanted to be a millionaire. Okay, well, now you have nothing, right? We started out with $288. What's 288? Well, you got to say now that needs to be $2,888. You know, you got to be realistic. Times have changed. It's been 50 years, and but it's not a whole lot more. We could argue that it's $3,000, $4,000. But if you get yourself a nest egg and you get started, that's the main thing. Then you have a chance. No matter what your direction is, be it, let's say you want to be the state representative from the state you're in. If you don't start meeting your neighbors, this is not going to happen. And as you meet your neighbors and your neighbors' friends and the rest of your neighborhood, and you go door to door, which is now the custom, at least in the states, the two states I live in, going door to door and trying to meet everyone that's in your district, having face-to-face contact, whether it's totally positive or, you know, you can control it, it won't get out of hand, maybe a little bit negative in some points. I've been door to door a couple of times when I thought our democracy was in peril. I'm getting my mind around the idea of having to spend time to do that again this year. You have a goal. Even if you don't know you have a goal, you have a goal. Do I want to sit in this type of environment that I'm currently in and not expand my horizons? That's acceptable as long as you're comfortable in it. But most of the people I run into and talk to, even if they're retired and want to play golf every other day or even every day, at least they have a goal. They're doing something. They're getting some kind of exercise. nutrition, exercise, those are important things in our life. I think that helps.
Yeah, I think so. You know, you got to eat right, drink right, you know, got to have, you know, a great perception of who you are and how to be able to, you know, get to where you're going. When they talk about, you know, when you're creating plans, you got to use this pen here to create plans. You know, you got to create a working model for your life as far as goals and projections and actually how to start, you know, locking yourself into your perceptions, you know, locking yourself into your plans so you won't deviate, you know, too far off, you know, really like concentrate on this is who I am, this is where I want to be, and these are actually the steps on how I'm supposed to get there. You know, and as you're moving through life, a lot of times it gets in the way. You know, you experience losses in the land, as we're experiencing now with COVID and things of that nature, losses of business, losses of, you know, people that we really care about, you know, past things that we took for granted that we always thought was going to be there, that they're no longer fixtures in our lives the way they used to be, and actually how to counterattack those things and create a new, you know, stepping board. Like when I was young, they had the seesaw, right? You know, they had these seesaws when I was young in the park. When I go in the park now, I really don't see those seesaws in every community. And I think some of the seesaws was taken out of communities because the seesaw is a representation of collaboration. It shows that I can't get high or low if somebody else is not there with me. So in certain communities, the seesaw was taken out of the community so it can basically disrupt the concept of collaboration. So it can actually dim light on what teamwork actually is and what teamwork would mean. And then sometimes, you know, we on the seesaw, it may be three of us on each side on the seesaw, right? Not just one person, because now we're learning the element of teams, element of marketing, you know, of strategies, of advertising, right? And yes, as you said, according to our new government and the new regime that we're under, the concept of teamwork and collaboration, it's in-house, but in some way, it's not out-house, right? It's internal, but not external. And it has to be on both fragments in order for it to work. It can't be on one side and not the other. Both sides have to work collectively in order to bring forth change. It's like creating a nonprofit. If you don't have a squad analysis and you're not seeing the internal and the external aspects of a business, then your business is going to fail. You know, as Ronald said, if I don't meet my neighbor's not going to meet me. They're not going to know who I am if I don't go and knock on their door, if I don't create a commercial, if I don't do a giveaway in the community, right? If I don't go into the colleges and find out who the new leaders in the colleges is going to be once they graduate and actually present them with new laptops and new cameras and new iPhones, things of that nature, so they can actually be and this leadership realm, then when these individuals come out of college, they're not going to know who I am. They're not going to be my constituents, you know what I'm saying, in my race. They're not going to be my advocates. They're not going to be my volunteers and the promoters that I need in order to get myself from being on the couch to being on their couch, right? You know, it's like, how do I go to their house and sit on the couch and get a cup of tea, right? You know, like, how do I get there? You know, it's about illuminating our lives, you know, and not what I would say to myself this morning, you know, you cannot be selfish with your gifts. You cannot be selfish with your insight. You cannot be selfish with your purpose. You have to bring yourself into the space of others. And if you have this superpower, then share with others, you know, so you can see what their superpower will be like in the next 3 to 5 years. Like, what is some of your plans that you may have to not just increase business, but how to increase the business of others? You know, how to say, you know what, we need new seesaws in our community, and we need you to bring these seesaws back in our community because we need to reintroduce the concept of collaboration. So this is Denise Colson. She says, stay focused. I totally agree with this.
Yes, collaboration is progress. As you bring other people in and other people give you ideas and help you to grow, then that opens up the next level. You have some people that are very close to you that help you make your first step, and then some of them stay with you and some of them say, you know, I got other priorities. And so you have to fill that void, and as you grow with people with better and better vision, that helps you to achieve more interesting results.
That's correct.
The world isn't about total, well, let me correct myself. If you follow the money, you usually find out who's behind what's happening.
Yeah, that's true.
That's just the fact we have to live with. And but what you want is you want to find like-minded people that want to go in the direction you'd like things to go, and build on that.
That's right. You want to be, you know, you have to, like, you know, we're talking about about excellence, right?
And right.
Yeah, right. Excellence it's is, like, you know, I'm listening.
If you build trust in yourself, okay, and you prove that you're a trustworthy person, and then to have good values, whatever that means. Okay, I'm not sitting here telling you have to believe one thing or the other. Do you have good, mm-hmm. solid values? Do you treat other people well? Do you manage your life well? If you not manage your life well, why don't you think about deciding to manage your life well? And if I were to loan you $1,000, do I have a reasonable expectation that I'll get the money back? If I back you to win a congressional election and you go into Congress and you totally betray all of our joint values, I need to do a lot to get you unelected the next time around. So,
oh yeah. Oh, don't support the next election.
Collaboration,
you know?
That make the world, in your world, work better for you. So that's what I'm thinking.
That's right.
My thoughts.
I agree with that. I agree with that because, you know, we meet people in this world and we really don't know what path they're going to take us on, you know, and how they're going to be able to help you redefine, you know,
correct.
Your own essence, you know? And, you know, people at times, they see things in you that you don't see. And a lot of times, you know, we may betray those expectations because we're caught up in our own world instead of the world of excellency, that world of teamwork, that world of faith, hope, love that people don't want to talk about. A friend of mine had put a post up on Twitter the other day, and she was saying that, you know, we have to start focusing on love, peace, you know, faith and hope, instead of focusing on war and destruction and you know, and economical disparities. And I watched that post for a minute before I even made a comment on the post. I just watched it. And it was really ironic to see that nobody really responded to that post. They just left that post there, you know what I'm saying? Like dead fish in the water. And I wound up making a comment to the post and saying that, you know, we have a world that we're dealing with spiritual. We got spiritual leaders. We now spiritual leaders over the world, religious leaders. You know, we have these prominent political figures and things of that nature. And none of them responded to that post. And I was like, this is very ironic that we live in a world where we actually promoting religions and God and, you know, righteousness and things of that nature. And people actually be multimillionaires by calling themselves pastors and things of that nature. But nobody want to touch the space where we're talking about love, hope, compassion, forgiveness. We want to come outside that space. We don't want to be the person that says the wrong thing in a room so we get kicked out of the room. You know, and I'm one of those individuals that may say the wrong thing in a room. But when I'm saying it, I'm not saying it for the purpose of saying the wrong thing in a room. I'm saying it because my spirit is telling me what to say inside this room. Like, I didn't come to this room to disrupt the room because I don't even know what you're going to say when I get to the room. So there's no way to actually map myself out to actually be an advocate against change, right? I didn't do that, right? I came in the room and I started hearing terminology that was actually going against change according to the way my spirit basically analyzed change or becoming to awareness of change. And they're saying, well, you know what? He's not part of the room. You know, and I'm like, wow, you know, like I was doing a speech a couple of weeks ago and I never got invited back to do another speech from this certain component I was working with because I asked a sound question. I said, we create these laws, these policies, we create these bills, but how many of us are going to be alive 1,000 years from now to actually come back and revisit these laws, these policies, these bills, these legislation that we created to see what they're going to do to the people, you know, a century from now? How many of us actually going to actually have the ability to come back 10 centuries from now and say, look what I did, right? And look how the people are benefiting from it or not benefiting from these policies and procedures I put into place because I'm just trying to live for the moment, right? I just want to be this 21st century person, and I don't want to survive in the 22nd century or the 23rd or 24th or 25th century and be a conduit of change for my people that I'm never going to see again. And I think because we're so selfish with our existence is that we won't do things for future generations because we won't be there to share those things with future generations. And when I look into the spectrum of politics, I'm actually involved in politics and things of that nature as an advocate, as a leader, as a motivator. I see that a lot of policies and stuff that's involved in our current day time is like, it has to be for me. It has to benefit me in a moment. You know, it has to benefit my particular generation in a moment and not looking as far as like my generation might last, you know, let's say for the next 500 years, you know, when they expire, how would the generation that 500 years going forward will benefit from these policies and procedures and concepts I'm putting to the world? And I see that there's a space of what I would say, you know, self-imposing values, you know, self-imposing principles that's preventing us from actually pivoting outside of the space of self. Like, what do I get out of this relationship, right? And what you get out of the relationship is the prosperity of people that you would never know, that you would never see, shake their hands, sit on their couch and have tea with, or any of those anything of those nature, but they will benefit from the life of you. Yeah, I can't hear you. I can't hear you, man, for some reason.
Oh, what a nice concept. Okay. I like that concept. Right. Yeah, and I think I live my life that way, but I had never framed it before. I'd never framed it like that. That was pretty phenomenal. I like that.
Yeah.
Now you're officially quotable. Very, very quotable. Probably many times in the past, but I have a limited perception, limited time period. I like that. Yeah. The more people you can benefit from me, more people you can benefit. I like that very much.
Yeah, because I remember,
Twitter, she said, you can look at that two different ways. Now, here's the quote, and I'll tell you, it really inspired me. The quote was something like, the next phone call you make could change your life. Well, from my perspective, being a positive person, I said, yeah, really good. I guess I better keep making these phone calls because I know where I want to go, right? And she said,
that's right.
I've received a couple of those phone calls and I wish I'd never received them. So there's two different ways to look at that one. But was inspirational to me. Make another phone call. Try and move the direction you would like the world to move, or where you'd like to move it. And I think it was a guy. It might have been a woman. Don't know. And said, "Thanks. I really needed that to propel me forward."
That's right. Because
you never know.
You never know. You know, they got the concept where Denise Colson stated that me, my, and I, you know, it's basically like the concept that people are using, me, my, and I. It's supposed to be we, are, and us. It's called an act of selflessness, right? And because, you know, when I look at life, we are life forms, right?
Right.
And if we are life forms, you know, if people talk about life and they talk about all the beauties of life, right? You know, the animal kingdom, the planet kingdom, the human kingdom, or whatever. If we are what they say, we are the essence of life, then we should know without a shadow of a doubt that we never die. If we are basically a translation of what life consists of in its many different forms, have created us in so many different forms and created so many different type of planets, some different plants or animals and insects and things like that, which shows that life is a recurring vessel, right? It constantly moves. It doesn't stand still. Those that stand still in life, you'll see them sleep on the train or the bus or the sidewalk and things of that nature because they have stood still in life. And life doesn't stand still. It's constantly moving. It's constantly shifting. It's constantly pivoting all the time. It's not waiting for you to catch up because there's nothing to catch up to. It's moving. It's telling you to move because it's moving. You can't catch up to time. You can't catch up to life. Every time you and I are talking right now, the seconds have been moving off the clock, right? We've been in the show right now for 33 minutes and 44 seconds. And now it's 45 seconds, right? It's constantly moving and constantly shipping us into new spaces, into new awarenesses, because as Denise says again, we need each other in order to bring forth change. Without each other, we cannot bring forth change. As you just stated right here, the next phone call, you know, could change your life. You know what I'm saying? That next phone could change your life, save your life, move you in a whole different perspective. And you're saying that, you know what? You know, as again, no purpose, no directions, right? We have to have purpose in order to bring forth direction. But it's also oxymoron because without direction, it also has no purpose, right? So this is light that's moving in real form. We get to shift concepts and terminologies and linguistics and things of that nature to actually show, you know, oh man, this is what I can do with this. I can change that concept. She said, no purpose, no direction. I said, nah, there's no direction, no purpose, right? And then we can just play with this all day like a seesaw until we find that spectrum. That hidden space, that golden era, that golden space that's meant only for us. And those that choose to take this journey with us and be that what they would call the sacrificial lamb of society, that sacrificial lamb of what life entails, of you stepping outside the comfort zone and you being that ultimate sacrifice, and not, you know, not losing your life, but increasing your life and increasing the lives of others. You know, I may look on TV and I say, they say, this guy's a leader. He's a leader. And I say, okay, if this guy's a leader, if this woman is a leader, where are the 200 cohorts or the 500 cohorts that's following them throughout the land? Where are they at? Why are they not working with 300 people and 500 people, right? Where is that synergy at? Why is just you in the room, everybody looking up to you and saying, oh my God, he's the leader, she's the leader. Why aren't the rest of us in his space? You know, I had a conversation with a cousin of mine one year, because my cousin, he constantly says, like, he said, he's a Christian. I said, okay, you know, there's nothing wrong with being a Christian. There's nothing wrong with any of those things, right? And I said, but you know, it's something in the Bible, you know, that I ran across. And he said, what's that? I said, I think I ran across the scripture where the Most High said that he give different people different gifts. And he looked at me. And I said, well, you know, I've seen your gift, but I also seen other men bring gifts to you, and you deny every man's gift because you thought that your gift was greater than every other man. And I said, you need to understand that the Most High may give you wisdom, but he might give me understanding of your wisdom. The Most High might give you a purpose, but he might give me clarity on how you bring that purpose to fruition, right? If you don't see that the Most High has provided many men different gifts, then how would you call yourself a Christian when it's inside your Bible that the Most High has provided many men with different gifts and not all men have the same gifts? You might be strong in one area, but I might be a phenomenal in another one, right? And because you didn't see this gift of other men,
right?
You lost your gift, because your gift was given to you to basically gift others. And you didn't see it. And that was in a time when he was in a space, you know, unawareness, where he was like, what am I going to do with my life? And I'm like, well, you know, you've been riding for like 10 years straight, you know what I mean, with no hiccups. And in them 10 years, the Most High brought you thousands of people to help you along the way. And every person he brought to you, you said, you are beneath me. You cannot help me elevate. You cannot help me get to the next level. You know, like I reach out to people on my pod, you know, on social media and say, come on my podcast. And they were like, well, you know, I'm more phenomenal than you are, Nathaniel. You know, so there's no reason for me to come on your podcast. And I say, wow. I said, you know, you don't know who you're going to meet if you come on my podcast. You have no idea who's going to come across you in the world. You have no idea what this opportunity is going to do for you. Somebody's going to see Ronald on his podcast and say, yo, man, come on my podcast, because my podcast is named such and such and such, and this is what I'm doing. And next thing you know, that new connection is going to basically save your life and bring you into a new direction. I know I took up a lot of time, but yeah, you know. Yeah, so you, Ronnie, you can tell, you know, I know I took up a lot of time, and you know, but I definitely get excited about these things. Yeah, I can't hear you for some reason. You might be on mute. There you go. I can hear you now.
I really touched anything. Okay, sorry.
Huh?
I do not have a very forceful voice. I have to tell you that. I learned that long ago. When I ran for student body president in high school, I got trounced. That's okay. It was a good learning experience, because it allowed one of my daughters to become the student body president where she went to school. And they were both comparable the number of students. So she did a hell of a job. Anyway, she learned from my mistakes. It's one of those things. But I had a lot of support from a lot of different entities on campus. It really felt good to have such a diverse group of people behind me, and that's where I want to be. I like that. It's important to me, and we learn as we go along. And if we're learning, then we're most likely to become a better person. There are some great books that teach us things. There are great people that teach us things. There are people to listen to, and it doesn't take a lot of stress and strain to grow. It takes an open mind to grow, but doesn't take a lot of strength. You just have to be interested in the world and look for opportunities to learn. And learning is invaluable.
Yeah,
seeing the world definitely is invaluable.
Yeah, seeing the world, that's right.
So I wish some of our more conservative brethren would get out and go to different parts of the world. They sure have a much better idea of what America is all about.
Yeah. Yeah, you got to see it from, you got to come outside of the box to see actually what's inside the box, you know. And as we locked into America, we don't see what America really is, because we're trying to make
good in the world.
Yeah, we're inside America. We're inside this nice little cluster of a safe space, you know, and our perception is actually limited because we're not seeing it from a whole nother spectrum. You know, I mean, we don't have that telescope that we can look from Mars and into the world. So we don't get to see how the world's really functioning and how the world's actually moving. It's like even with, you know, you see Denise up here. Denise is a great friend of mine. You know, I met Denise many, many years ago. And our friendship broke and it came back together and things of that nature. And this world just shows you that, you know, our lives connect in many different ways, and sometimes in the world things, you know, they shatter, and then the universe in a way helps us, you know, cultivate those relationships and befriend those relationships, you know. And I definitely want to bring Denise on this platform as well, because she has a great journey and she's been moving on and things that she's been doing in the world, and people need to know her testimony. They need to also know what her story is, you know, and how life can get in the way of the things that you're doing, you know. And this is why I created IAMTHEDATA, to show people that, you know, there is a fluctuation of life. You know, there is at times where you may be going strong and then your light dims and then you gotta go strong again, you know, and you gotta keep striving and keep pushing, you know what I mean, at that threshold until you're able to break through on the other side. There is no utopia. There is no one size fit all. You know, you have leaders that come on and they say, if you do this, this is going to happen. No. That's not true. That's not true all the time. You know, you may try to apply everything that they try to apply, but you may do it without your true spirit, without being your authentic self. So it don't work out for you. You can't create a framework of your life if your life is not a part of that frame. You have to be a part of that frame in order to create this basic concept of what life is, or this context of what life is, you know what I mean, for your own life. And this is how you find your umph, right? That umph. You have to find that umph in the world that's going to tell you, yo, man, stop being so shallow with your life, right? Stop making excuses with your life, you know what I mean? Step out on that ledge. Step out on that ledge, man, you know? Hope you got that parachute so you could jump, right, and pull that string before you hit the bottom. But, you know, step out there. You know, like, do some new things. Like, be creative, man. Be explosive, you know, and be loving with who you are, right? There is no, you know, like I said to people, you know, will you live 1,000 years? And they might take it as an offense. Like, what does he mean? You know, why would he say something like that? And I'm saying this to tell you one thing, man. right? Enjoy the life that you have while you have it, right? You're not going to live 1,000 years on this spectrum right here, because we haven't been given 1,000 years on this spectrum. There has not one man been alive for 1,000 years that we know. You could go into the Bible and you could talk about these men that was in the Bible, and they lived for 900 years, 800 years, and 500 years. But according to this time and era, we live in like 100, maybe 120 years on tops, right? For some of us, but not a lot of us. So how do we benefit from this life of 100 years? You know, how do we benefit the 100 years that other people have that came into the world, right? How do we do it? Right, I was watching a show one time, and I'm gonna try to find it again. I can show a clip of it, but it was the Twilight Zone, and it had a man. A man said he don't like people. He don't like people at all, but he loved to read books, you know. And those books was created by other people, but he didn't like no one. So something happened in the world where there was nobody else in the world but him, just him by himself. And he was so happy because he stumbled upon the Library of Congress. The Library of Congress had all these books, and it was just books scattered all over the steps and things of that nature. So he sat down and he said, you know, I don't like people, but I love books. And he picked the book up to read a book, and his glasses fell. And when his glasses fell, his glasses broke. And he couldn't read one word in the book because he had no more glasses. And where's the glass maker at? Where's the guy that make glasses? There's no one here, right? No one can fix the glasses because you don't know how to fix glasses. You don't know how to create glasses, right? So now you sit in the world by yourself with a broken pair of glasses and many, many books that you enjoy to read, but no man is going to help you to fix your glasses so you can get back into reading your books that you really enjoy. And you forgot that it was mankind that actually created the books that you read, and also constructed the glasses that you use to see. And that was a priceless lesson. I never forgot. I watched that thing years ago, and I never forgot that one scenario, because it was so phenomenal. And it showed that, yes, we do need each other in ways that we can never even imagine. Yeah, I can't hear you, brother, for some reason. It's like you slowed up, but we'll fix it. You back now? Yeah, I can't hear you. I don't know why. I was going over the reception over there, man.
What a great show. Yeah. The Twilight Zone that you remember. I got one that I remember too. Funny.
Share it with me.
Funny. Interesting when you.
I want to hear it.
I don't know why. Is this better? Is this better?
Yeah, a little bit.
Okay.
I don't know why I keep going in and out, but I can hear you.
I'm still here. If you can hear me, raise your hand.
I can hear you.
Okay. I don't know. I'm here.
Yeah, it's some type of delay, but you know, that's, I don't know why
the machine's
happening.
Says I have good. Good, loud, and clear.
Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear you.
Nothing you can see on your end, huh?
Yeah, I can see it, yeah.
You can hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you.
One thing at a time. Right.
That's a fact.
Okay, so Twilight Zone, there's a picture of a group of army reservists and they were out doing some maneuvers, and over the hill they heard some Indians, and they were surprised, and one of the tanks went over the hill. I don't either, sorry. My entire system went down the day I got here to California, when I transitioned for the winter down to California. Yeah. And the technician came in yesterday and set me up. It was horrible. 2 days without internet, something that we never knew about 20 years ago. That was just not easy to deal with. But I'm so glad to know that everyone told me I was going to be up to time for this show this morning. So that was a focal point.
That's
to
right.
Make sure this happened. Third time the charm. And very.
Well, do it again. Do another one and make sure that everything goes right, because I think that.
And it's so nice that you and I share this vision of where we could move the world. We can move the world to be so much more inclusive and caring and trying to help other people reach their goals and objectives. And whatever they are, I want to be the best carpenter in the city. Well, let's figure out what you need to do to learn more about carpentry to get you to be the best carpenter in the city. Who's the second best? Let's go find him and see what we can learn from him.
That's correct.
There's so much that's possible in the world.
That's right. There's so much possible.
We need to be the best representatives to encourage that kind of collaboration and common interest. I think I could negotiate with most people and end up with some kind of path forward. I always figure that even if I'm the last person in the room in a discussion, I usually end up with something I really wanted. I don't know how that works.
Yeah, it's good. Yeah, you know, basically what they call the law of attraction, right? So when you go into a room, you know, you have that entity about yourself.
I'm not hearing you now. That's interesting.
You're not hearing me
at all.
You don't hear me?
But we're here. Both here. Crazy. Same room.
Okay. Yeah, so, you know, it's the law of attraction. Hear me now? Yeah, it's some type of delay. I don't know what it is. I'm actually going to be.
What we're here to do is spread the word and make the information available to other people so they can ask us questions so that we can help them see if there's what path forward they might want to take, or what change they might in the city of Portland, Oregon. They have a terrific gang problem, and no one's quite figured out how to get these people disconnected enough that they can all do something potentially positive. Gave a presentation.
I don't know what's going on. Yeah, we definitely got to do a round. We got to do one more.
And
we gotta do another show. Ron,
they started a success group. Success in me. And the person that started it informed it, said Everyone's success is different. Yeah, exactly.
That's right. That's correct.
I hear
agree
you.
With that. Yes, I was basically right saying there. That the reason why you'll get things when you go into the room, the reason why things come to you because of the law of attraction, you know, and through the law of attraction.
I'm hearing you okay. You'll be able to, I'm seeing your lips moving. Right, I get the same word.
Yeah, so I don't know, but the law of attraction brings us
I don't know
to
what
a
it
new
is.
Space and a new time. It's just
important to
delay,
encourage each other. I don't know who put that up, as you know who yourself.
And I hope that was Denise that put that up there. You know, everyone's success
really
is different.
Good. That's right.
You know, it's true.
I found
true.
That. And I had all kinds of people come up to me after the presentation, and almost to a person, they told me what they were trying to do in the world. And some of it was straight line, some of it was upward mobile, some of it was very hopeful but doubtful, and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. It was the most interesting phenomenon. I enjoyed making that present quite a bit.
That's great, man. That's great, because, you know, everybody doesn't know how they're going to do what they need to do. You know, this is why we need guidance from one another. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, sometimes we bring clarity to the room. We bring clarity to other people's purposes, other people's journeys, right? To show that, you know, there is like that love and embrace that's in the world, which we actually need. We need that love and embrace. And that love and embrace is the continuity of our change. Within that love and embrace brings forth change, brings forth awareness, increases perception, right? And strengthen guidance. You know what I mean? Without guidance, we're not able to actually move in the direction that we need to move in. And we definitely need that mentorship from others to help us. You know, I may be, you know, let's say I may be a poor man financially, but I may be rich in spirit. But I may need finances in order to be, you know, conducive on both elements, right? But then I might meet someone that actually can assist me, and that person might be weak in spirit, when I can actually increase their spirit, and they may be able to increase me on another level. So it's all about that continuity of care and that space of love and that space of hope, you know, and that space of awareness that we have to bring ourselves into the room. Yes, we won't forget about wisdom, Denise. Wisdom is so important. You know, Mozart said, get wisdom, you know, but with all your wisdom, get understanding, right? So, you know, it's those type of things that's really important, you know. And I'll let you have your last word too. We're going to do another part of this, because the reception was not really the way we wanted to be. We wanted to have a well-oiled machine, so we're going to come back and do another part three of this show with you and I. You know, we're going to keep going until we get it right. You know, yeah, we're going to keep going. You know, so with that, you know, IAMTHEDATA is going to end in less than a minute. Yeah, IAMTHEDATA is going to be going. Yeah, call me after the show so we can talk briefly. You know, I gave you my number on LinkedIn so we can talk. You know, IAMTHEDATA, you know, look forward to these conversations. Look forward to building.
I have some ideas. We need to talk on the phone.
Let's talk. Yeah, let's talk. Yeah, call me. You know, you got my number, right? Please give me a ring after the show. You know, everybody that tune in, subscribe, share this with your cohorts. You know, let's reach to another plateau. Come on the show. Let's have a discussion. I don't do discussions. You know, and I look forward, you know, to everybody to have a belief system, have a value system, has a journey that they've been through, they want to express. You know, tag me, man. You know, reach out to me. Let's explore some new things. And with that, you know, Ronald and I is going to say peace and blessings to everybody, and enjoy your day.